Hello and welcome back to Inkpot, and this is part three of painting Bolo. And here is where we were at last time. We had just finished up kind of the other side of this face, and we did a lot of work on the teeth, a little bit on the gums and lips. Now, since last time, I did a little bit more work on it, and I'm just going to show you guys quickly what that work, how that work turned out. So here we go. And this is kind of where I'm at now. Now, as you can see, I kind of redid this area in the head here. And I also added the horn on the side here, and I added just the kind of like dangly bits that he has coming off of his face there. I noticed that there is another set of skin kind of that kind of bands between the jawline and the cheekbones there. So I just added that in for now. So I kind of just, I did do more on this side, but I decided to erase that because I want to show you guys kind of how I did it. So it's easy enough for me to work head on one side, I figure, and then I can go back to the other side and do the same thing basically, but showing you guys how I got there. It's probably the way that the rest of this will go, even though I'm not sure how much longer we'll be working on this before it's complete. All right, make sure I'm on the right layer. And I'm just gonna lower the size of that. Must be cool to have like those, one of those boards with your hotkeys and then kind of like a, one of those like circular, kind of roly, I don't know, dials that you can kind of on the fly used to change your the size and stuff of your brushes. I'm really jealous when I see people using those. I'm like, that would probably be really handy, probably speed things up quite a bit. There are hotkeys that you can link on the side of the Unova, but like a lot of stuff on the Unova, it works, but it's just not, doesn't work as good as it should probably. I finally found out what was causing the interference though on my monitor. So that's gonna greatly improve, my experience while doing these live streams. It was actually my camera. So the power cable for my camera, I thought it was that, so I moved the power cable and I moved it to a different outlet and everything, hoping that would just solve any of the issues with it. But apparently it wasn't that, it was the actual USB cable. So now I have the USB cable going into a hub and then into the computer, and I do get a little bit of that still, a little bit of that kind of odd kind of static bar that goes up on my screen, but it's barely noticeable now, which is great because before it was really annoying trying to see what I'm actually doing while I was doing these streams. It's funny because sometimes it wouldn't really be an issue, but sometimes it just seemed to be worse than others, so I'm not sure exactly why that is, but it did seem to be the case. And now I'm happy, like I said, that it's seems to be done with, so that will greatly improve, probably greatly improve my ability to go longer on these streams too, just because I'm not dealing with something quite so annoying right in my face the whole time. Can be a little bit disorientating too, like when you're trying to do some detail work and your screen is constantly kind of have an upward motion to it because of the way that the interference was coming across the screen. So but not gonna have to deal with that anymore, thankfully. Hopefully that's the case. Just grabbing the gouache blender here, just want to smooth out a little bit of that stuff that I just did, soften kind of the edge there on that. Alright, going back to my oil brush again. I'm doing something similar to what's in the photo on this one, my photo reference, but I'm not doing it completely. Kind of like before, like I said, you know, reference is there. Not, you don't have to strictly follow your reference. In fact, that's when you start getting better, I would say, when you start just using your reference as like a reference point and not as something you're just straight up copying. I think then you're going to find that your success and kind of growth will go up greatly. Good way of doing that is just to kind of use your reference, but change up the color a little bit. It's always a good way to start if you're just starting to kind of figure out how to use your reference. So at first you want to just copy it so you can get your technique down a little bit more consistent in the way you draw and stuff, but it's nice to actually move on a bit and do, like I said, the first way is probably changing up color, putting in different highlight colors, like a secondary highlight color into stuff. Even just changing the content of what's there. Early on in your art, it's good to kind of simplify stuff that way. So you can kind of go in there and just simplify stuff that might be giving you some issues. So what I mean by that is somebody's wearing like a patterned shirt or something, you can always just concentrate on the folds and you can instead do it kind of like a you can do it with kind of a solid color and kind of ignore the pattern in the shirt at first. You need to start, I think, when you're first beginning, you want to more focus, less on detail, which is funny, because that's what most people decide to focus on first, is the detail. But you actually want to focus mostly on the you're first starting out, just the general shapes, getting like, there's no point in doing a patterned cloth until you can nail that cloth looking like cloth, you know. All right, move on to this tooth. We'll see how much we get done today. I'm always constantly surprised that stuff takes longer than I expected. As I'm sure you've realized from watching the streams, is sometimes I'll after an hour I'm shocked how little that I've actually gotten done, but it's generally most people when they watch me work are like, "Whoa, you're so fast!" But is kind of one of the things, though, that I have been working on is kind of taking my time more. Before, I used to tend to rush things. And I kind of just want to see, you know, I was feeling like I was just kind of rushing my work and not doing my best work all the time. So I still have a tendency to rush through certain parts and stuff and leave stuff that I know I could have done better, but you also don't want to get into the point where you're not moving forward just because you're too busy trying to fix and perfect everything. So it's kind of like a little bit of a takes a little bit of work to find that happy medium. I think in October I want to do more just kind of do as many streams as I can and just do work mostly on more original stuff, not just so far I've just done other people's characters and stuff. I think I just want to do some more horror related stuff that's just gonna be whatever I can come up with out of my head. And that's just going to be like on the spot. I'll probably spend more time in the sketching process, trying to figure out where I'm going and what I'm going to do. But I think that's a better give you guys a better of an indicator of like where I'm at as an artist. With my compositions and characters that I come up with. And it'll just be nice to do stuff for Halloween too. As cool as like licensed characters can be and fun that they can be to draw. If you're always doing that, it's like I was saying before, it's kind of like it becomes a crutch and you're not kind of moving forward with your progression of your artwork. So I'm going to try in the October to focus more on that kind of stuff. I also have a hard time though, like what's scary to myself, because I'm very much into horror films and stuff, and the more exposure you have to that stuff, the less seems scary to you. So it can be difficult to kind of come up with those ideas. So it'll be a good exercise too, and just being able to come up with that kind of stuff on the fly. I'm just going to do my blender there. I need to kind of expand the width of this tooth a bit more. Oops. Grabbed the wrong tool there. I was using the pencil tool, which I've never really used much except for kind of the sketching out part of coming up with my compositions in Clip Studio. I'll just use the blender, bring back some of that. And I'm just going to zoom out here just so I can kind of assess how that's going. Now, I do like the front teeth here. I'm just not a big fan of what I'm doing with this tooth. I'm just going to looks metallic enough. It just doesn't have a very nice shape to it. That's better, but I'm just gonna bring this down, grab some of that darker tone. Let's try the tooth on the other side here. One thing I never got used to is sometimes you'll work with people that will like basically want to kind of sit over your shoulder as you work, and you just don't do good work that way. I don't understand it. It's probably just on their part. They are not they're not experienced in, you know, working being painting or doing anything themselves, but it is very strange thing to deal with. Now, it's different if you're kind of going over and it's a consultation and you're kind of sketching stuff out as they're kind of describing, just to get an idea of what they want and get you both on the same page. That I understand. But when it's fairly late in the process already and you're just, I don't know. Don't know what you can do, and you're just kind of when you're waiting, I guess it's because they're waiting on you. I don't know though, it slows down the process for sure. Though when someone's just sitting there over your shoulder watching everything you do, even worse if they start commentating on it, because then you're just going to end up going over and over and over stuff that you've, that you know you're just kind of putting in for now and that you need to work a little bit more on. So you get stuck on spots. It's definitely a weird situation. I hope, some of these people can kind of learn from not to do. I know it can kind of be like, I'm paying for this, so I want to see what's going on and want to make sure that you're working hard and on what you're doing, and I guess that's what the motivation where that comes from, but sure doesn't help any more work get done faster or anything. At least not in my opinion. Maybe some people work good that way, but geez, I doubt many do. Like I said, there's a kind of a time and a place for that, and it's in that very early sketching kind of phases where you can be really loose and stuff, and you are trying to figure out kind of what you want together, but I haven't really had that issue more than once, or like that was really any kind of real problem. Most people clue in as watching someone paint isn't always all that entertaining, and then they realize, hey, I got some stuff I need to do too, so let me just leave you to it. Once they kind of see like how you're progressing and how much time it's actually going to take, in that way it might actually be beneficial if someone doesn't have any kind of realistic idea or expectation of time frame on how long stuff takes. That's always one of the worst questions that you get asked. Well, how long is this going to take? Generally you can give them kind of a general answer, but to be honest, everything takes as long as it needs to take to look good and be done, you know? I mean, you do have to check yourself if you're one of these people that just can't put it down and you're constantly don't know when to say done is done. That can be an issue for sure. But, for the most part. You know, stuff is done when it's done. How do you know when you're done? You'll know that, you know, when anything you're adding at some point is really only something that you are going to notice, you're probably done. Not really happy with kind of these outer teeth, but I think zoomed out though here, they're okay. That's kind of like, that's kind of the rationalization you kind of got to do yourself as well. Kind of notice if what you're doing is really adding anything or if it's you're doing it for any other reason than it to look better, or if it reads fine the way it is or not, you know. Also with like, I like to jump around a lot, like I'm almost at my end of working with these teeth for now. I might have to come back to them. You just get to a point where you're just like, okay, I kind of realized now that law of diminishing returns of working on this section right now, where I feel like I'm maybe spending too much time on it and it's taking too long. Sometimes it's just good to switch it up, and then mentally when you come back to it, generally you end up going so fast, so much faster. It's weird. And sometimes your brain just needs to recharge on a certain thing. Need some time to mull it over. You don't even realize that you're doing it, but when you come back to it, you definitely see a difference and stuff that was an issue is no longer really being an issue. And it's just because you need a little break from that area of it. That's why it's nice to have kind of these bigger kind of pieces where you can kind of jump around a little bit. It's a lot tougher if I was just really zoomed in on like more of like a female face or something. It can be a lot tougher because you're dealing with larger spaces that are just kind of not as much detail going into them. And where it's kind of the stuff you're working on can be a little bit samey, and you don't get any as much relief from trying other stuff. Okay, so some other stuff that I did up here. I really like how this turned out. It's just way lumpier, more like how he actually looks. If I turn Bolo back on here, he's kind of got these lumps here. So I just emulated that look a little bit better. I think that the lighting direction I had originally in this one, it just looked flat and it looks like just a bunch of ridges and stuff, and then as opposed to this. I'm just gonna grab the ink drawing. Oops. drying layer, and I'm just gonna pop that up here too. Another thing I would just try it out too, if you didn't notice here, is I put a glow dodge layer, and that's just that same green from the eyes, just in a really soft brush put over both sections, and I have that layer set to color dodge right now, and it kind of just adds that like glow effect to it a little bit more. If I turn the ink on again there, the see what I really wanted that for is I just want to get a sense of where I put some of these lines in here. Oh, it's just saving right now in the background here. All right, got this. I'm on Blender right now, that's why it's not showing up. Just make sure I'm on the right layer. Bring that opacity down a little bit more. Let's just add some of these details in here. And turn off the ink layer. I'm gonna have those little details there that I wanna make sure I don't forget about. Now, right now, this has more of that brushed aluminum look to it. So I'm gonna bring out some more highlight in this part as well. And just grab that again, a darker color. Just make sure that comes across there. Now grabbing some more. It's gonna have a little bit stronger highlighted parts here. Grabbing my oil number 3 brush there again. And just gonna grab the gouache blender there. And push that paint around, digital paint around a little bit. To me, it's kind of the same effect as you dabbing your finger on a traditional set of acrylic or something. Now, obviously, this isn't really that accurate to the cartoony version of Bolo, but kind of just wanted to do my own thing. Because I've always liked his design, but I just wanted to kind of realize it in more of a slightly more realistic manner than it is in the cartoon. If you haven't watched Final Space, you really should. It's kind of an emotional roller coaster of a show where it kind of starts off as this one thing, but the character growth in that show is unbelievable compared to a lot of other animated series. It's hard to compare it. I think that's the problem, is a lot of people try to compare it to other things that they've saw, and it's so different. Doesn't really fit in the same box as a lot of the other stuff that's out there. The character design of every character I really enjoy. It's some really creepy, cool looking things. It'd be interesting if they did do like a more serious science fiction show, like those, like Olin Rogers. I think that's who created Final Space. Like, I know he's working on a, seems like almost like a D&D or RPG video game kind of comedy series coming up. But I'd love to see what he could do with just a straight up more of a dramatic science fiction piece, because what he did with the drama in Final Space is like better than most science fiction TV shows, in my opinion, out there right now. So, all right, so that keeps a good kind of like brushed aluminum look to it there. We'll add some more, like, I'll probably add like another ambient light coming up, and I might change the color of the ambient light just to give some more interest, but I'm gonna leave that till the very end, I'm thinking. Just so it doesn't overtake everything that's going on here in the piece at this point. All right. Now he's got these like, it's kind of blue things here that in the horns that kind of go up and across and swoop. What I think I'm going to do is I'm going to do kind of like a crack in it, and then have a glowing, have that same glowing green that's in the eyes kind of come out of that there. So I'm just going to grab a thicker brush here. I'm just going to go in there and let that come, and then I come back in there. Then I'm just thickening it up, and then I'll add the glowing light from the inside after. And I'm going to grab my kind of purplish highlight there, and I'm just going to run that along the edge for now. I mean, that's going to probably be that green. But it's just going to sell a little bit more that that's an embossed kind of, or debossed area of the horn there. And just grab my eraser and just cut a little divot out there. That will help sell that too. And I'm just going to grab another highlight thing here. Then we'll probably add kind of something to kind of texture the horn a little bit too. Maybe some cracks, or I don't know. We'll figure that out as we go, I guess, here. Oh, it's not getting selecting the color I want there. Let's just grab that one there. There we go. It's better. I'm just gonna grab that darker green there. Just put that in there. Just grab that. Grab a softer brush now this time. Bring that down in size quite a bit. Oops. And grab my soft brush there again and stick in that area. Alright, so that's kind of cool. Then I'll probably go on this color dodge layer. Turn that back on and grab the bright green. Then we can just kind of give it that glow there. Yeah, it's kind of cool. Zoom out here. All right. Back to the bottom layer there. Just gonna grab just grab the darker color there again. Just smooth out that transition for this kind of webbed piece that we're doing here. Now the hair in the background here, I just did that on another layer and I just wanted to put in kind of some stuff rough for now. Just to give me kind of an idea of how that kind of contrast will work between kind of the blue. And I was like contemplating going brighter, but for now, just for the start of it, I'm just gonna be doing this kind of lighter, or not lighter, darker kind of tone in there. It's good to use a brush that actually tapers, so something like that. Now this one has a dual color kind of mode, which is good, but then you can have more variation in your actual kind of brush stroke, but works and it doesn't work. I find sometimes it just might as well be a solid color, really. You can get way more hair like kind of shapes going on with this kind of brush. In theory, that brush should be really good for doing hair, but I find that it's a little lacking. Alright, I guess my music I was listening to here ended, so I'm just gonna grab a different soundtrack here. Throw that on. Just working on the hair here, giving it some highlights. There are some people who can do this really nicely in like just a few strokes. Me, I'll usually go over the highlight and kind of like the shadow a couple times, a couple passes on hair. Just try and get his kind of mutton chops in there. And let's just go in there in the darker color and start making sure we have some layers of hair there. Am I gonna do more Final Space digital art? Possibly. It would be nice. I have had ideas for certain stuff. Doing more like almost like an Avenger style poster kind of artwork for it. But more in my kind of style. And yeah, it's definitely something that I've had kind of in my head, so I probably will at some point do some more fan art of Final Space for sure. Avocado fangirl. How good of a character is Avocado? Lil Cotto is pretty awesome too, though. Bolo, though, his character design, that's why I wanted to do this. It's just unbelievable to me. It has so many, I brought up before, it reminds me so much of Zdzisław Bikinski's Untitled painting here. To me, that's so similar to that, and I've loved that guy's artwork. It's so creepy and eerie, and it's so similar to me to the design of Bolo. I thought that was pretty awesome. I don't know if they did on purpose reference that character or not, but or that piece of artwork or not, but definitely seems to be some sort of an influence there for sure. Soundtrack too of Final Space is something I use a lot when I watch or when I'm doing my art. Right now though, I've been hooked on the score for the new Dune movie coming out. When I'm doing these streams, it's almost impossible to listen to something that has any kind of vocals. They're just distracting, and I don't want to shut down and not talk while I'm drawing. So, but yeah, that Final Space soundtrack is pretty awesome. I'm so bummed that they're canceling that show. That last season was so good. But you never know nowadays with stuff being canceled. Everything comes back eventually, so Seems that way, at least. As long as the fans are there and as long as it was quality to begin with. I think Olin Rogers was talking about video games being a possibility too, which I think that series was ripe for really many different types of game styles of games. So it'd be fun with those characters and that story and lore. I think I'm just gonna move on from the hair for now. Still needs quite a bit of work in here for sure. One thing I did set up is I made my own brush oil blender that I'll probably go in here and use a lot more to kind of just soften up some of the edges of some of the hard edges that I've made in there. But it's nice because it kind of pushes paint around to kind of like a point, which is kind of what you want when you're getting that hair texture in there. But there's kind of where we're at so far with it. The horn's going to need a lot of work. I'm trying to think of, like, texturing wise, how I want to go about it. So I don't want it to be too heavy handed, but I don't really know how I'm gonna do that as of yet, because it's just too smooth. Even like the original drawing of him, he's kind of got these like different shapes and stuff in there, and I'll probably have to look at some more reference of actual horns. Usually it's kind of reminds me of like almost like a bunch of stalks of spaghetti all shaped together. Usually there's lines that just kind of go run from the root to the tip. I'm just kind of giving an edge light right now to that, just so it sticks out from the background a little bit, even though that's all going to be probably his hair, because I have this ink layer here. I'll up the opacity of that. Yes. So there was my original sketch drawing, just overlaid on top of everything. So I'll probably have all this kind of hair in back here. That will probably fill out a lot of that section. But by ink layer, I don't mean actual ink, like digital ink. This is mean line art. I like to do my sketches more in like a line art kind of way for my digital paintings. It just helps me figure out more of like where I'm going to have hard shadow and where I'm going to have highlight a little bit. Sometimes it helps. Sometimes it's just more, it makes you feel like you're working on a coloring book, which is not a bad thing. Which is also a great way if you're learning to digitally paint or learning to just render 3D shape. It's really good to kind of start with coloring books. Then you're not really bound to the you're not worrying all about form, and you can just worry about rendering the shape. By rendering, I just mean that what kind of, oh, I'm on my blender. I'm like, why is that not doing what I want it to do? By rendering, that's just you drawing and painting and doing what you can to get kind of the shapes and an image that you want. A lot of people use quick keys for a lot of this stuff, but these menus, I don't like to, when I'm just using kind of like a my pen here anyways, they're quick enough to go through. I don't find it would save me much time. Remembering a bunch of quick keys. That's a little heavy-handed, so the way I can do that is just bring it back, is just bring the darker color into the lighter color. And as a person that used to be against these blending brushes, I've sure become a fan of them lately in Clip Studio, mostly because I found ones I like, either by making them or by using the gouache blender. I'm a real big fan of, just because it has some texture to it, and I really like that when you push harder on that one, everything kind of disintegrates. That here, like, it adds a real nice cool texture that looks really natural. But like I always say, I'm not one of these people that thinks that your digital painting should look as much like traditional painting as possible. It should have its own look. Otherwise, you should just be working digitally or traditionally anyways, in my opinion. If you're hung up on it looking like that. Alright. I'm just going to put another kind of edge highlight on the back here. Just for now, it's going to make that pop out a little bit more. Stop me from probably overworking those areas because they look incomplete. So just mentally, it helps sometimes to do stuff like that. Let's see what I can do. I was thinking about possibly trying one of these hatching brushes here. Kind of add a texture to not really liking the look of that, though. If I do it in the highlight. I'll have to think about that part some more. Alright, should I go back to the teeth? I'm going to start working on this side. So, like I said earlier, because this is what we had last week, was this. And I wanted to expand on that, and since I didn't record me doing this section, I will do it on the other side. Even though I did do it on the side already, I'm going to do it again just because I want to not have big gaps, and if I'm doing it on one side first and then going to the other side, people can kind of see how I did it. I'm just going to pop my ink drawing back on over it. I'm just going to grab, I'm going to turn off my glow layer for the eyes there. All right. Oh, this is kind of, I have the light kind of coming up from under. I'm just gonna I'm gonna work that back and forth. Get that kind of highlight going there. It's where traditionally you'd be building up paint. Here we're just building up some digital paint there. I'm not going to worry about the horns there right now, or whatever those are on on his head. Kind of like spiky shapes. So I do like this kind of like bluer kind of shadow that I was getting as I got further up on the head. I'm just filling in those areas. Right, and now just lightening up those sections a little bit more. Another good way of doing this is you kind of just do it flat out to the edge there, and then you can come in and do those. It's another way. By flat, I mean you just kind of get your base kind of shading in there first, usually with like larger brushes. By that I mean, see, I could do something like that, and then just you kind of work your lighter tone all the way up, and then you can go in there and detail it after. I'm just going there to do a little bit of both going on there. I'm just going to turn off my ink drying there for a bit, so I can get a better look at what, or line drawing is more accurate of what that was. Let's grab my shadow tone there. Just making sure I got some shadow to these kind of areas too. Something doesn't work, you can always go back in and redo it. It's the nice thing about digital, it can get a little bit muddy, but with digital at least you can just go in there and straight up erase it if it's getting too worked over and it starts getting kind of a muddy appearance where you're getting you're kind of losing the highlights and the shades. I'm using a Yenovo MSP 19 Plus, I believe, is what it's called for my monitor, drawing monitor. Not great. Would not recommend nowadays, but like when I got this like a decade ago, there wasn't much on the market for stuff besides Wacom, and I could not afford that, and I still cannot afford that. But you can still get a pretty good look and feel by using even not the best equipment. All Just kind of giving the brow a little bit of shape there. Now, even though I put that edge highlight there, I probably won't have that there. I just wanted to put that there so I know kind of where I want that shape to kind of go. So I'll probably just do something more like that. Less, still an edge highlight. It's just not as sharp. Could have softened it up too with the gouache blender, but just decided to do it that way. So there, that's how I did basically this other side here, and looks fairly similar. Actually, it looks better in places, which is good. I'm just going to grab this color here, and I'm going to turn back on my ink layer, and I'm just going to add in those little horn shapes that he's got there, little spiky areas. I have a habit of working from dark to light. Just how I work. You don't have to. I think that's from coming from working with acrylic. Growing up, acrylic paints. I just find acrylic paint works best for me when I work from a dark, from kind of the shadow to the highlight. Now these I'm kind of giving kind of a different appearance than I did the horn. But I may actually have to go in there and kind of do that same kind of texturizing to the horn, too. These are definitely not near complete of what I have in mind for them, but this is a good starting point. Now some of those kind of remind me of almost like eye stalks on a snail or something. Some of these shapes that he actually has in the cartoon. I'm gonna use something similar. There we go. Just for now, getting that in there. Yeah. So he's definitely looking creepy enough. I just want to grab kind of more like a peachy tone here. And just in the highlights in this kind of area here, I'm going to add that kind of warmer tone. It's just going to make that kind of look different than this area, which I'm kind of going more in that aquamarine kind of tone in the highlights. I'm just gonna grab the blender here and smooth out this kind of chin area a little bit. This is kind of what I would do in with acrylics too, is I'd usually have a there's like an actual dry brush technique where you dry out the paint on your brush and then you can smoothly gradiate. Or you can have wet paint that you kind of drag with a dry brush. And that's kind of the same kind of technique that it's just the same thing but digital. The same idea. Just connect these areas here. And build up that side a little bit more. Yeah, and a little bit of a highlight on that edge. That's kind of missing. All right. I'm just going to try to grab that kind of green that I was using over there for it. And I'll grab that kind of more peachy tone, even though it over top the green, it's more of this like more of another tone of green. Zoom out here. Show you guys here more of the close up. Oops. The zoom in this program. It's so heavy handed that I'm sure there's a way to change it. I just don't know. Okay, so that's kind of where I think I'm gonna leave it at today. And then hopefully tomorrow I'll try to get the rest of the head done, and then we can move on to the body, and then hopefully within 5 episodes we can get it all complete. The last episode I'll probably just be in there fine tune putting the finishing kind of details and stuff. That's where I'm probably going to do a lot of this texture work and such. In the meantime, I will probably do a little bit of work on this side. I'll probably do a little bit of work on filling out this side, at least to this point, sometime later tonight off stream. But like I've shown already, the techniques that I've used on this side. So I'm just trying to keep on doing that. So I'll basically be working on the left side, and then I'll show you guys the right side live. Just gives me more direction of where to go in these videos. And I want to thank anybody who stopped by today, and I want to thank Avocado Fangirl for asking a question. I hope you guys can all join me, and I'll probably be back again tomorrow around the same time for part 4 of Painting Bolo. So thank you very much for watching, and I want you all to stay creative.